So nice to meet you all. And I am Karoliina Luoto from Kodento, from Finland, and from Agile Finland, by the way. We just had Agile Finland coaching camp last weekend, and it was a blast. I strongly recommend you to go on one of those. I'm mainly focusing on lean and agile customer work as a coach. I'm working with product managers, decision makers, leaders, the folks that are deciding on things, basically. And what I wanted to talk to you about today, oh, I have this clicker I can use, is metrics. Because I think metrics is good to have on place when you are doing a project, so that you actually know if you are building the right thing or not. Because otherwise it could happen that you are just building, being happy, you know, proceeding great, like always succeeding all sprint goals and stuff. But what if the thing you are building is not adding any value to anyone, or is the wrong thing for the business? I think usually, oh yeah, I have a question for you. Hands up the ones of you that think you have metrics on place with your project, some metrics that you know with that you are succeeding or not. Hands up. Okay, we can again look around. It's like maybe 10% of the people or less. Okay, this is interesting. Yeah, what I think usually happens is that you just, if in the happy case, you have a kickoff of a project and you are having this whole, you know, objectives and goals discussion together with everyone, and maybe you even take out some canvas, like a business model canvas or lean canvas or something like that, and then just, you know, use the orderer, the product manager or the customer gut feeling, you know. They know their customers, they know what people want. So let's just put what we have on the canvas and then go with that. This is one of ours. This is a software vision canvas where you, well, you can read. I won't read it through. So you could even do something like this in the kickoff. What do you think is the problem with this? Any ideas? Again?
They just forget about it.
Oh yeah, they forget about it if it's not hung on the wall. That's true. You could, though, maybe hang it on the wall afterwards. Any other problems, maybe?
It's not alive, though.
Sorry? It's not a living document. Well, that is, yeah, that is really precise and really, really true. I mean, you need to come back to it every once in a while if you use something like this, right?
Also, yeah.
It's not, yeah. Yeah, how can you act on this? It's just goals, not a plan for proceeding with the project. And still, I'm kind of going for something else. I'm saying that, okay.
It doesn't describe any measurements.
It doesn't describe any measurements. That's what I'm going for. It isn't based on any data. Somebody can say that person X is our customer, but you haven't actually validated it in any way. And that, I think, is the problem with this kind of proceeding. Oh. It's keeping us awake, the mics and how they act. So what if the people who are filling in the canvas just don't see the world right? What if they are blinded in some way? You know, people have a lot of opinions that they like. So it could be that they have never actually fact-checked them, their opinions. And that's what I want to talk to you about today. So all of you guys sitting there, you actually have all it takes to make your product managers, your customers, whoever is paying for your work, you can help them see what's valuable and what's not. It's in your hands. First, I'd like to focus on, on who and what they need. Who of you have some kind of market research or user research thing going on in your project? Hands up. Like 5-10 people, maybe? I'm saying it doesn't have to be that sophisticated or official. I mean, just putting up a Google form, this is Finnish, you don't have to understand it, but the pictures, they are important. Taking out a Google form, it takes you maybe like 5 or 10 minutes to make. Having a link on whatever, front page is relevant to you. Maybe you can imagine it's a thunderstorm or something. It would be appropriate for this summery day. taking out the Google form, putting it on your front page, starting to find out about who the people are that are using your service, what devices do they use, what do they like the best about your service, what would they wish, what do they hate, what greetings do they have for you, do they have any suggestions already that, hey guys, you should fix this, or please focus on that, that would make my life so much better. I mean, why not do that? It doesn't require basically anything. But of course, what you then get out is like quantified data, like, we got 200 answers and like 50 of them thought this page here sucks or something like that. Of course, then you don't know anything about why or how or, what their life is like with your product or in their everyday life. So I would recommend you just take one day, maybe go to a street or wherever your users could walk or act or whatever they are doing, and start digging deep. Just ask the questions, like, show me how you use our service. Show me where the problems are. You can have the person like using the service with his or her like phone, like she is doing over there, and you can just like go like behind her shoulder and start looking how she is doing that, and you get so much info in like so little time. And yeah, it's not even time consuming. And often, like, whoever is ordering your services, be it the product manager or whoever, they will get like mind blown with what you find, because there will be 10 or like 12 like really valuable things they haven't even ever thought about. Not in their wildest dreams, because they have their own fixed understanding of your customer, and they never even thought it could be wrong at some point. Okay, I'll just stay here so you can hear me. And how you can make this research that we just did here together real and updating, as some were say, live in your project. You could even form a user panel. It could be simple. It could be just 5 email addresses or phone numbers. And whenever you bump into a hard question in your project, like, should we design this way around or that way around, then you have like someone to ask from. And the important thing is that someone doesn't have a fixed opinion on how this product should be like, but they are really talking about their need and what they are willing to pay for or what they are willing to use time for. So it's like, it's not objective, but it's subjective in the right way. Okay. So we have kind of handled the metrics for need and who, since we have actually measured what the people are like, and we have actually asked the right people what they want. And we are proceeding to solution, what kind of solution should we be doing, on feedback, like how to validate the solution is right, and then on unique value, which is what kind of differs us from all our competitors, what makes people buy or use our product over all of the possibilities they have. I mean, they always have possibilities. If not anything else, they can choose not to actually use your service because it's too hard or time consuming or something. Still, you can ask the users. This is the Kano model by Nokriaki Kano from Japan. Who has seen that model before? Hands up. A few?
Like what?
Yeah, I'll explain. So this is an unhappy customer here, or user. This is a happy user. That's a non-made product. And this is a completed product. So you just take the users from your panel and start asking them how they would like your product to be. And what they first will answer is that, well, okay, you are building a cafe, so I would like some cakes and then some, like, maybe, you know, tea and maybe like a nice space for it, and that it would be in the city center so that I don't have to go far. And now in comes the unique value or unfair advantage. What they won't probably mention is that they would maybe, or they can mention it, that they would want fast speed Wi-Fi, or that they would want to pet cats while they are having coffee, or that they would want to lie down instead of like sitting in chairs. So that would be your unique value in your cafe then. But the problem is that there are also stuff that they won't mention. For example, that if the coffee is bad, they won't come. Or that if the air conditioning is bad, they will start to feel uncomfortable in a little while. Or, yeah. But, I mean, then if the other stuff is good enough, then they could maybe kind of get over that, as it's the case here. But anyway, you are in a bit of a danger then if you miss some of these, you know, like base stuff, like that they won't mention, basic stuff. So what you can like basically do is start asking about your product and then by the answers figure out on which of these curves do the features you are wanting to build belong. The hard thing is, of course, that there's an arrow here that you can't see. It's coming from here and going to there, and that's time and your product. The problem is that, for example, in cars, I have a really old car, so I don't know, but at some point, like, cup holders was a fancy luxury thing that you can put your coffee cup somewhere in the car. But as the time goes on, of course, the competitors find out about it, and in a year or two, all the cars will have a cup holder. So that's no unique value anymore, and you need to then figure out a new value. Like, okay, let's take something from our industry. Like, 5 years ago, it was luxury to have a mobile-first site that looks good on, like, you know, your mobile phone. And nowadays, it's just the basic thing you have to get figured out. And then you need something else there. Okay, so now you have the user, you have the user panel, you know what they are wanting, but what you don't want to do is just start coding and then maybe find out 2 years later that you kind of went wrong with it. So you have to prototype, at least somehow. I mean, you can use pen and paper, or you can just like build it really kind of roughly and quickly, just to, you know, make it real for users, like how will it be. So when you have a first idea of a solution, just prototype it in the quick and dirty, you know, quickest possible way, and then ask the user again, would this maybe solve your problem, or was it something else that you were meaning? Is there already a problem in this prototype that you see? And how you can measure the answer? This is one of the most classic metrics there are, the Net Promoter Score. It's missing an S there, but that doesn't matter. How it works is that you ask your users, how likely would you recommend the product that this paper prototypes describe to a friend? Zero is like, no way would I recommend this. I mean, I don't want to, you know, risk my friend's life. And 10 would be, most certainly I will. I love this product. And now this metric works like, you take out all the 7s and 8s you got, and then you minus the amount of like 0 to 6 people from the amount of 9 to 10 people. Like, so how many gave 9 or 10 minus how many gave 0 to 6, and you get out a percentage that could be like 20, which is like a mildly happy case. It could be negative, and that means you are screwed. So you can just, you know, try it out. And if you want to make it even more accurate, you can just sit down with your user panel and make them play poker. How it works is that you have a rough list of features, like the backlog, but not in its most long, refined mode, but just a rough, you know, it could be a list of epics or a list of like rough features. And you make the users actually play like planning poker on those, but they are not doing, who has done planning poker, hands up? half of the people. Well, I'll just explain this one. You play for epics or rough features. You play for one feature at the time, like, for example, search, or like Facebook login, or something like that. And you ask the users how valuable they think the feature is to them. And then they have cards, and they are just, you know, putting the card on the table all at the same time. And you'll get one, you'll get five, you'll get 13. And then you can maybe explain a bit more about the feature if it kind of seems really like a big scale. Then you can maybe ask the users to kind of talk to each other about why she thought it was one and why you think it's a 13. And maybe they could play it again. Yeah, and you can see if their opinions have kind of more collided together. But the thing is that now you have a basis for value tracking in your project. You went through the whole backlog, even though roughly, with your users. And now you can just, you know, it could be just text, whatever pivotal tracker or Jira or Trello you are using, you can just put a value to every epic or every, you know, whatever user journey spot you are thinking about, and start tracking on how the value for the users is proceeding in your project instead of the workload or work estimates you are used to tracking. Because this is then what is actually valuable for the users. So yeah, you can just add it simply as a text. We have an example here. The numbers in the parentheses are the value numbers, and these blocks you can see here are the regular estimation points. You see? So it means that there's this shop list that has been valued high. It's 13.25 for the vote that the users have made. Then there's the Easter egg that is like 5.25 for users. And now you can see that we have used a lot of work for that Easter egg. Like radically less for the shop list. So how would you figure this is going? Any ideas? Yeah, I think so. Or you can start tracking the user value as a value burn-up chart. How many of you have drawn some burn-up or burn-down charts in your lives? Quite a few. So you could just take the same tool and start tracking value. You take those value points and just start drawing the, like, your proceeding. Taking whatever cadences, sprints or Kanban cadences you have. So tracking value as a value burn-up. And at least for my experience, this is the thing you want to have when you go to your project board or whatever, you know, steering group you have. And this is what you want to show, that we have gotten out this much value of the weeks we have used for developing. All right, guys. Now we have covered need, who, solution, what's like extra valuable, what's basic. We have covered feedback, is there hope for our product, and the unique value and how it's proceeding. And we are just about to cover one more, which is business metrics. So how do we know if the direction is right? I mean, now we know about the product, but how do we know that it will solve anything for the business? What if it's a, like, it's a brilliant product and the marketing has gone wrong and nobody finds it? Or it's a brilliant product and, like, you know, nobody uses it anyway. Often the projects are about new business. It's about, like, satisfying new customer needs that we didn't know how to satisfy before. Then it's, how are the numbers with the new business? Whatever you think with business, I mean, it could be purchases made, it could be downloads for you, your whatever PDF, it could be contact requests, it could be, I mean, there's many things that business can mean, but whatever. And how would you think this project here is going with its business metrics? yeah, maybe a bit bad since, you know, it's kind of declining towards the end.
It depends on what the rest is. Maybe it's the cost of the feature that it is going here.
Yeah, that could be. Depends on the context. What did someone there say? Okay, I just missed it. I'm sorry. But maybe not every time is the business metrics the right answer for measuring this. So it could be, again, the customer satisfaction. We did something, and then we just, again, need to figure out, as we have the ready-made product in our hands, and we trust in it, and it's beautiful, so maybe we want to, again, ask whether the people would recommend it to their friends or not. This can be quite cold sometimes. I mean, it could be that the answer is, like, not good. But you'd rather know, right? So that you know what to change in the future. And then I just have one more suggestion. Sometimes the project could be a bit internal in its essence, for example, or none of those metrics kind of work. So what you could be measuring is, like, lead times. It could be about starting a new account, and before it has taken the user, like, 5 screens, 25 minutes, and typically 6 errors before it's, like, completed. And if you can turn it into 1 screen, 11 minutes, and 1.6 errors, then it has been actually a pretty happy case, because the user's life has become so much better. Or sending a new invoice, it's an internal thing, and you can just check the lead times. Of course, you need some research for this again, but I mean, it's really good to know. And it's really good to have an objective like this when you are starting the project, that, okay, it's about internal work, so we'll just focus on making the time used for the task smaller. So this is basically the metrics that we need. The rest of the canvas is about actually implementing the thing, and about, like, technical vision and restrictions and stuff. If you like this canvas, you can find it from our site, godento.com. But now I would like to want to know that how many of you will change something when you get back to the office? Hands up. This is my cold moment. Like 10. All right. Whatever. Thanks for your honesty. I'm done here. So, oh, I have one more thing. Do you know this picture? It's from Anti-Fragile by Enen Taleb. Has anyone seen it before? No? Oh, you have? It's a turkey. And he's very sure of himself. He's like, I know this world completely, and I'm great at, telling things from before, and I know how the development will go. The demand for turkey, it has been very kind of stable lately, and we have nothing to worry about. Now, what do you think would be the thing that this turkey doesn't know? Thanksgiving is coming, and he'll be dead tomorrow. So I'm just trying to say that maybe the metrics aren't, you shouldn't maybe, trust it blindly, but keep your eyes open at the same time. Thank you.